Okay, good evening. Welcome. Today is week three of our close reading of Stephanie Kelton's The Deficit Myth. Here we come to chapter two entitled Think of Inflation. Can I just see a thumbs up to make sure that some people, my audio is coming across okay? Okay, good. So I would like to acknowledge at the outset that you are likely to find this chapter challenging for two reasons. First, chapter two is long. The range of concepts in it is large. In this chapter, we encounter many terms and concepts found in conventional macroeconomics. We are all at least half familiar with these concepts because they are taken for granted as forming the conventional wisdom of political and economic discussion in the mainstream media and in national politics. Modern money theory, however, is critical of many of these mainstream concepts. If we're learning MMT, that means we have to learn the conventional concept, learn why MMT thinks the conventional concept is wrong, and then learn the counterposed MMT concept. That's extra work for both teachers and students. The second reason why you may find this chapter challenging is that Stephanie Kelton was presumably writing this chapter in 2019 before the COVID-19 pandemic, before the impact of the pandemic on production supply chains became evident, and before the inflationary period that began in the spring of 2021. So she was writing in a period when consumer prices were not rising sharply, and when inflation was more of a theoretical issue rather than a problem coming into view over the horizon. This means that her analysis may feel somewhat inadequate today. In particular, she begins the chapter by stating that in reality, quote, for evidence of overspending, look to inflation, end of quote. That runs the risk of suggesting that inflation must be due primarily to overspending of some kind. And it tends to dismiss the possibility that inflation might be due primarily to supply side problems and only secondarily to excessive monetary demand in some sectors of the economy. That being said, there is a tremendous amount of value in chapter two. We should bear in mind that from the time around 1995, when modern money theory began to emerge, up to the start of the pandemic, the principal political economic issue MMT advocates were concerned with was persistently high unemployment and the waste of human resources that unemployment represented. Unemployment rose dramatically following the start of the Great Financial Crisis in 2007. And remained persistently high for years afterwards. The recovery time for employment following the Great Recession was much longer than for all previous recessions since the Great Depression of the 1930s. This massive waste of human resources was the principal socioeconomic problem of concern to MMTers in the period between 2007 and 2020. Now, MMTers were not the only people concerned with unemployment, but only MMTers had an innovative policy idea designed to respond to persistently high unemployment. That policy is the Federal Job Guarantee, or JG for short. Taking advantage of its position as the monopoly supplier of the currency, the federal government would offer a position as the would offer a job to any unemployed person who wants one at a fixed job guarantee wage, roughly equivalent to the minimum wage plus Medicare for all type health benefits. This would basically solve the problem of involuntary unemployment. It would provide a pool of labor organized at the state and local level to work on projects the private sector is not addressing. And the job guarantee wage would serve as the anchor of the price structure. The job guarantee program would be a countercyclical program of the kind economists call an automatic stabilizer. In times of recession, laid-off workers could enter the job guarantee pool and maintain their employment history. As times get better, private sector employers can hire workers out of the job guarantee pool by offering wages higher than the JG wage. Remember those three phrases that I mentioned in week one of this course? What does happen? What can happen? What should happen? The job guarantee is the prime example of the second phrase in that group. What can happen? The job guarantee is a policy which is fully imaginable within the overall framework of our current economic system. The period between the great financial crisis and the beginning of the COVID-19 pandemic was a period of massive underutilization, not just of human resources, but of real productive resources like raw materials, machinery, and equipment as well. Persistently underutilized resources meant that there was little upward pressure on the prices of those resources. So as long as those non-human productive resources were available for purchase in the country's currency, they could be purchased at relatively stable prices. MMTers cautioned, however, that if those real productive resources came into short supply, or if there were excessive monetary demand for those resources, whether coming from consumers, investors, or government spending, then the economy could hit an so-called inflation barrier, at which point prices would rise. So, for a quarter century, MMTers were primarily concerned with underutilization of productive resources, particularly the waste of human resources represented by unemployment and underemployment. There was one situation, however, in which they turned their attention to a possible shortage of productive resources. In May 2019, Yevhen Nersisian and Randy Ray published a Levy Institute working paper called How to Pay for the Green New Deal. In this paper, Nersisian and Ray argued that, one, climate change constitutes an existential threat to human life on this planet. Two, the crisis posed by climate change can be addressed by the kind of Green New Deal program which Senator Markey and Representative Ocasio-Cortez introduced into Congress in 2019. And three, the Green New Deal is both technologically and financially feasible. Nersisian and Ray acknowledged that a Green New Deal would involve a massive 10-year-long restructuring of the U.S. economy. During this period, the federal government will have to take steps to guarantee that resources for the fight against climate change take priority over resources for other production and consumer goods, lest competition for those resources lead to inflation. Nersisian and Ray believe that this is a challenge with which the United States can meet for the simple reason that we met a challenge like this once before in World War II. The broad outlines of how to finance the Green New Deal derive in large part from the ideas developed by British economist John Maynard Keynes in his 1940 pamphlet, How to Pay for the War. When the COVID-19 crises, both medical and economic, hit us in March 2020, much talk of the Green New Deal receded, though the question of how to deal with mass unemployment did not. The U.S. experienced a recession which was both very sharp and very short. By early 2021, it became apparent that while demand for consumer goods had resurged, the world's capacity to produce those consumer goods had contracted sharply and unevenly, leading to the supply chain crises we've all heard about and to a much sharper rate of increase in consumer prices than the U.S. has experienced since the early 1980s. Not surprisingly, inflation has become the most discussed economic topic in the media. If you had followed Stephanie Kelton's Substack blog in recent months, you'd have seen that she's talking much more about inflation now than she was back in 2019. So let's start by getting a taste of what Stephanie Kelton has to say about this in chapter 2 of The Deficit Myth. So at this point, we'll move into, as we have done in the previous 2 weeks, we'll move into the discussion questions, which have been posted both in the Slack channel and on my website at learnerminsky.org. You will note that I made a few small adjustments to the discussion questions over the course of this week. So if the discussion questions appear in a slightly different order from what you have in your printout or however you have it, don't be alarmed. It's just that there was a certain amount of duplication, and I reread chapter 2 in preparation for this course and needed to make a few adjustments in the questions. So as in previous weeks, I'll be going through the Zoom window, asking people to unmute and come on camera when I call upon them. Take your best shot at providing an answer to the question. If you were not able to do the reading material and do not want to hazard a guess, please simply say pass and try to catch up on the reading material for next week's program. Okay. So the first questions are definitional. I'm going to ask you to explain terminology used by Stephanie Kelton in chapter 2 of the Deficit Myth. And the first term that I'd like to get defined is fiat currency. Stephen Crozier, can I call upon you to tell us about fiat currency?
Steve, you should be able to unmute.
Okay, yeah, I got it there. Yeah, I can try anyway. So a fiat currency is a currency that is not really dependent on another form, like say gold or something like that, that it needs in order to substantiate itself, if you will. I'm not sure if I'm using the right terminology. So in a sense, it's free. It's its own currency. It's something that it can pay its own way, if you will, without depending on something else.
Okay, thank you. Let's see, is there anyone who would like to add something to that? That is a pretty good definition. Kuba?
Yes. So what I mean, from what I got from Stephanie Kelton's writing in chapter 2 was that fiat currency is not pegged to let's say gold or silver, and the government no longer promises to convert US dollars into gold. So it can issue as many dollars as it wants. It doesn't have to worry about actually running out of a supply of gold. So let's say if somebody were to go to the US government and say, hey, I would like to, redeem my paper dollars for actual gold. If there's, if there's not that much paper currency out there, that's fine. But if all of a sudden there's a lot more of paper currency and people, there's a run on the bank, essentially run on the US government, the US government's going to run out of actual gold to supply. So the fiat currency system allows the government to spend, to issue more paper currency without a fear of, essentially going bankrupt because they don't have enough gold, or whatever is, whatever the dollar is pegged to.
Okay. Very good. Let's go on to the next term. the cost push and demand pull drivers of inflation. Marty Rowland, could I ask you to describe those?
Okay, I did read that in chapter two. So the cost push. So I guess that's spending in advance of a mobilization to increase jobs. That's my guess. And what was the other one?
Demand pull inflation.
No, I guess I'm gonna have to pass.
Okay. Wendy Rockwell, would you like to take a stab at that?
Okay, this is one of the questions that you changed. It wasn't there initially. Okay, but I want to get a stab at it. Okay, so these are both drivers of inflation. So it's what other economists have attempted to guess at to because they're afraid of overemployment, and so they reduce the amount of currency, or they change the interest rates to make sure that there's this amount of people that are not working that will prevent inflation. But I don't know, maybe I probably got it backwards, but.
Well, I think what you've described is more as policy responses to inflation. And what this question was asking about was more categorization of sources of inflation.
Mm-hmm. Jim, I could try if you want.
Okay.
Yeah, so they are both sources of inflation, but the cost plus inflation is when the cost of one or two or more factors of production create a situation where the supplier has to raise the prices. So it acts on mm-hmm. the supply side, basically. You know, a supply shock would be one example. The demand push is when too many people want one thing and there is not enough of it. So the competition mm-hmm. for the good pushes the prices up.
Okay. Okay. Yes, this Stephanie discusses this in chapter two on pages 46 and 47. And this is an instance of what I described in the introductory remarks as a situation where Stephanie is defining certain concepts that occur in mainstream macroeconomics. These are not specifically MMT concepts. And there have been much debated over the years. And the other thing that I would simply add is that at any given time, there are many factors that might lead to a general increase in price level or to a widespread increase in prices. And some of those are going to be of a demand type character. Some of them are going to be more of a supply side character. For example, as far as cost push inflation, she mentions that a serious drought could lead to massive crop failures and food shortages. Powerful storms could wipe out oil refineries. Food and energy costs feed directly into the consumer price index and therefore set off an inflationary process. Demand pull inflation, she describes as demand pull inflation occurs when businesses raise prices due to changes in buying habits. I'll refer you to the discussion that she has there on pages 46 and 47. these terms are primarily important so that when you're reading the newspaper or you're watching some sort of a YouTube video on economic issues and people refer to cost push and demand pull inflation, you're at least familiar with those terms. Okay, the next term that I'd like to get to have someone take a stab at would be the Federal Reserve dual mandate. Lucas, can you try to discuss the Federal Reserve dual mandate? What does that mean?
Good day. You hear me okay?
Yes.
The dual mandate is that the Federal Reserve not only has to control the amount of money in the economy, Canadian economy, use the interest rate. It's a kind of a dull tool, but that's what they use to control money in the economy. And the dual mandate is the fact they should also target as close as they can to full employment. In fact, 61 economists in Canada here went to the Bank of Canada last year through the finance minister to try and get that put in place more effectively than it is at this point. So it's a monetary control, primary and secondary, or should be equal, I should say, is full employment.
The question as I posed it was admittedly somewhat U.S. centric, because the term Federal Reserve dual mandate has a specific meaning in the United States, which it may not have precisely the same meaning in Canada or in other countries. If I were to take what you said and try to apply it to the United States, part of it would be correct, part of it would not be correct. Okay. So let me see if we can get one other person to discuss what Stephanie Kelton means by Federal Reserve dual mandate. William Batt, would you like to take a stab at that?
Okay, let's make sure I'm unmuted. Well, I my sense of it is that the Federal Reserve has two policy obligations. One is to attract as full employment as is possible, and at the same time avoid inflation, have stable prices, so that I think this is what for years was called the Phillips curve, but I'm not absolutely positive about that. But I do understand that two charges of the Federal Reserve is to make sure that full employment and stable prices are the key features.
You're correct in that. Those two things plus interest rates, but interest rates are seen more as a tool. Those were specified by Congress in certain revisions to the Federal Reserve Act in 1977. The Phillips curve is, we'll probably get to this at some point in the course. The Phillips curve is a concept in conventional macroeconomics that posits that there are trade-offs between fighting inflation, right, and fighting unemployment. And the Phillips curve was, perhaps still is, long a part of the Federal Reserve's analytical toolbox, we might say. I personally consider the Phillips curve to be nonsense. And in fact, I helped write a pamphlet criticizing the Phillips curve way back in 1975 when I was first in graduate school. We won't go into that quite now. But you are correct in terms of the dual mandate, and the dual mandate has been taken relatively much more seriously by the current and the immediate previous chairs of the Federal Reserve. Janet, I'm blanking on her last name.
Yellen?
Yes, Yellen. Janet Yellen, and the current chair, Jerome Powell. They take the dual mandate much more seriously than, say, Alan Greenspan did in the Reagan and Bush and Clinton administrations, and even that Bernanke did. Now the thing that I wanted to mention that is not part of the dual mandate is controlling the money supply. That number one, that would be a tool of the Federal Reserve, not necessarily a goal or an objective given to the Federal Reserve by Congress. And secondly, when in the period roughly 1979 to 1982, under Greenspan's leadership, the Federal Reserve was applying the monetarism theory developed by Milton Friedman and the Chicago School, which stated that the Federal Reserve simply increased the money supply at a steady rate and otherwise keep its hands off the economy. Well, the Federal Reserve found out that it could not control the size of the money supply in any determinate way. So it couldn't use the money supply growth to steer the economy. And the reason being that the growth of the money supply basically responds to the credit needs of the economy. This is a point that MMT makes and points that other things make. It's a bit maybe more too advanced for our course at this point. Basically, the Federal Reserve tried to govern increases in the money supply for a several-year period in the early 1980s, abandoned that, and largely pursued a policy of inflation targeting for the next 30 years. Okay. Next term, functional finance. This we had a bit of discussion in the before class discussion today. Functional finance. Can we get a definition of functional finance from David Johnson? Yes.
I'm afraid I would have to pass on that. I don't recall that from chapter two.
Okay. Oliver Liu.
First one I can't answer, pass.
Okay. Bonnie.
Okay. Functional finance is a fiscal policy. It includes taxes and government spending, as opposed to what the Fed does, is what I got out of that.
Okay. Functional finance is an approach to fiscal policy, and fiscal policy is primarily concerned with the inflows and outflows of revenue or currency from the government, principally expenditure and taxation. Can you be a bit more specific about what's characteristic of the functional finance approach to fiscal policy?
Well, it has to do with government spending. And since they're the issuer of the currency, well, I'm getting ahead of myself there, I guess. But they can spend whatever they want. And so they can take money out of the, out of the money supply, obviously. But functional finance means that if they can spend what they want to spend, then they can, getting back to her jobs policy, they could do all sorts of things. They wouldn't be limited in what they could do.
Okay. Ruth Kano, could you take a shot at functional finance? Unmute, please unmute yourself, Ruth.
I don't have all the right words, but I think that the purpose is to have a balanced economy so that the jobs are enough and there's not too much inflation. For example, they might reduce taxes on low-income earners because they will spend that money back into the economy. Policies similar to that, and they want to just keep the economy good.
Okay.
Achieving full employment, ensuring growth of the economy. Yeah.
Okay. Vicky Mueller Olvera, is there anything that you would like to add to Ruth's description of functional finance?
But yeah, I think that the policy is, we talked about this last week, and my takeaway was the policy is not about looking at inflation or whatever. It's looking at, it's judged by like if it's good for the economy, if it works, if it doesn't work, if it, or something like that. I don't know. I don't have the words, but yeah.
Okay. Okay. The one thing that I would like to add to what Ruth in particular was saying is that the functional finance approach, which was first developed by Abel Lerner during the later years of World War II, is counterposed to an approach which we'll sometimes call sound finance, with put that in air quotes because it's meant somewhat ironically, but that much conventional thinking emphasizes balancing the federal budget for the purpose of balancing the federal budget, making sure that government spending is 100% covered by taxes, in the same way that an ordinary household's budget has to be balanced. And the conventional sound finance approach basically says that balancing the budget is a value above all other things, and in terms, and especially above the overall overall state of the economy. So when Abel Lerner is saying that we should pursue a policy of functional finance, he's saying that, you know, government spending and government taxation should be coordinated so as to enhance the overall functioning of the economy much, much more than for the purpose of balancing the federal government's own budget. And part of this is this recognition that came in, I mean, if we look at the experience of World War II, we find that the government spending increased just to unheard of levels. And it was not as if there was like an increase in the gold supply during the war. And especially at the start of the war, it was not as if there was a big pool of savings to tap to spend to pay for the war. The government spent the money into the economy, and the spending preceded the taxation. That's a fundamental point of MMT. And then the government had taxation, particularly the institution of withholding, and the government had bond sales for the purpose of drawing money out of the economy, drawing spending power out of the economy so that there would not be inflationary pressures. So the financing was there aimed at the overall functioning of the economy and particularly the support of the public purpose, which was winning the war. Functional finance is a really important aspect of the way that MMT thinks about the economy. And it's consistent with other things that we've mentioned here already, such as that federal government does not need to amass funds via taxation or borrowing before it can spend, which in turn means that taxation and borrowing have other purposes. Okay. Let's move on. Next term is automatic stabilizer. Tom Rossman, can you take a stab at automatic stabilizer?
Yeah, so using the functional finance policies, you would stabilize unemployment by raising taxes and taking more money out of the economy, and spending more via the jobs program when the economy needs to be stimulated and unemployment's high.
Okay, I think the job guarantee, if it were implemented, would be an example of an automatic stabilizer. But I'm wondering, can you name something that already is an automatic stabilizer?
Well, I would say interest rates, but I know that you don't agree, so.
No, I don't agree. And since this is a definitional thing, whether I agree with it or not is not really the point.
I get it. You're right. Other than the unemployment and taxing to take money out of the economy when it's too stimulated and producing inflation, keeping supply chains, I mean, making sure logistics.
Okay, what specifically do you mean by unemployment?
People are unemployed above the target rate.
Okay. I want to get at least one example of an automatic stabilizer on the floor. Alex Sukatos, can you give an example of an automatic stabilizer?
Yes, when the economy is going downwards, then what you need is an increase in demand, and that can happen as a result of unemployment benefits, for example, coming into effect at that time.
Yes.
So it's done automatically without a particular new policy.
That's correct. People get laid off, they start to collect unemployment benefits, they have income to spend, so the downward effect of their losing their jobs is somewhat cushioned by unemployment benefits that helps to stabilize the overall level of spending and demand in the economy. And in the same way that once people go back to work, they're employed more, their taxes are being withheld from their paychecks, that's a stabilizer in the other direction. And especially what's important, and you mentioned this, Alec, is that this happens automatically. It's not as if, let me just cite an example from the United States. In the past, in 2020 and 2021, the stimulus checks, I forget what the Trump term was. Trump's term was checks signed by Donald J. Trump. Under the Biden administration, it became known as the American Rescue Plan. So there are these various stimulus things, but those had to be voted on by Congress. They stabilized the economy very well, as a matter of fact, but they were not automatic. They were not already part of the system. Someone, I believe Tom mentioned that the job guarantee, and that is clearly thought of as something that would be a further automatic stabilizer if it were implemented. Okay, now we move from these definitional things to two concepts that Stephanie Kelton is describing as present in orthodox economics, albeit she's highly critical of them. In your own words, describe these concepts and Kelton's criticism of them. The first of these concepts is monetarism. Ed Dotson, could you give a short description of monetarism?
This is Milton Friedman's theory that money basically drives the economy and that by establishing a steady increase in the money supply, however that's to be defined, you can virtually guarantee steady economic growth.
Okay. And that's a very good, short and simple definition yes. of monetarism. Okay. Let's tackle the next one. The natural rate of unemployment. James Frederickson, would you like to tackle Stephanie Kelton's description of the natural rate of unemployment?
My understanding of that is that at any given point, there's a certain amount of unemployment that is bound to happen and that could be reversed by appropriate government spending if it's too low, and that the government should rescind or should withdraw spending if the unemployment rate, if it's too high, and the government should withdraw its support or spending in the economy if the unemployment rate drops below a certain level. As far as I can tell, no one has been able to define what the
natural
rate of unemployment ought to be, or is.
No, I actually, if I may, it was defined time and again. Now it could change, but the emphasis was that it was natural, that there's nothing really that we can do about it without creating more trouble. And it's very important to underline the notion of natural there, because it implied again this favorite idea of Hayek and Milton Friedman, that we shouldn't really intervene in the economy very much.
Yeah, James and Alec, in your responses, you've actually captured two sides of a debate in conventional macroeconomics that was raging from about 1968 onwards. James, what you described is somewhat the concept that was mentioned a few minutes ago, the Phillips curve. And that what the sort of the approach that you were taking would have been taken by the more, you know, centrist to liberal economists in the 1960s, people like Paul Samuelson and Robert Solow, who posited the notion of a trade-off between fighting unemployment and fighting inflation, and who had a lot of confidence that the government could actually find the sweet spot between them. This notion came under really withering challenge from Milton Friedman, and he and a Columbia University economist of the day called Edmund Phelps came up with this concept called that it was first called the natural rate of unemployment. And Alec has mentioned the key implication of this was that that there's a certain natural rate of unemployment to the economy at any given time, and you can't do anything about it. So the government should not intervene, and the Fed should just pursue a monetarist policy of steady increases in the money supply, and so forth. And this became refined into a concept called the non-accelerating inflation rate of unemployment. You might see the term NARU, N-A-I-R-U,
yep.
Which was sort of like an even more pessimistic version of the natural rate of unemployment. And it's a very, I think it's a very ideologically laden concept. Because among other things, it denies the working class agency in terms of fighting unemployment, and it encourages a policy of government passivity. But that's my particular take on the issue. At this point, what's primarily of interest is the fact that as Alec mentioned, as various people have mentioned, there was an attempt to, you have a definition of natural rate of unemployment, but it's a concept that you cannot actually go out and measure. So that the economics journals, the Federal Reserve publications, for 40 years, a lot of speculation over what, you know, what exactly is at any given time the natural rate of unemployment. I will simply mention that a little encounter that Congresswoman Ocasio-Cortez had with Jerome Powell, the chair of the Federal Reserve, in 2019, Stephanie Kelton mentions it in this book, I believe in this chapter, and you can go on YouTube and see the video of AOC questioning Powell, and basically he is forced to concede that the empirical basis for policy based on the natural unemployment is very weak. From the MMT perspective, the political slogan, tax the rich to pay for the Green New Deal, is problematic. Why is that so?
Can you repeat it, please?
From the MMT perspective, the political slogan, tax the rich to pay for the Green New Deal, that slogan is problematic from the MMT perspective. Why is that so? Let me call upon Michael Leroy.
Yeah, okay. Tax the rich, I think, is a very fallacious thing to be doing. And I don't think it holds up. It's essentially stealing from others, in a sense, and that can't be right.
Well, no. The question was.
Yeah, I know.
From the MMT perspective,
I look at it differently.
Okay.
That's not what Stephanie Kelton is saying as to why not to tax the rich to supply the money for a Green New Deal. She's not opposed to taxing the rich. She's much in favor of it, actually. So that's not her point, I think. The point is that we shouldn't make it dependent on taxing the rich to pursue a Green New Deal, because we can do it through MMT.
Okay. Now this is one of these points where what I'm asking you is, what is the MMT perspective? And the phrasing the question that way, the hope is that you will learn the concept, whether you agree with the concept or not, that you can actually articulate the concept. And
I'd like to take a stab at it.
And so forth. Okay, Patricia Lowe.
Yeah, I don't know if I'm right, because I was a little confused reading it, but I think she said that even if you tax them, I mean, they're not spending that much to begin with. It might be that they're big savers. So if you tax them,
yes,
you're not taking, you're not taking a lot of money out of circulation as far as spending goes. I think
okay. That's
what she said, something like that.
That is true.
Jim, Oliver wants to try, I think. Oliver Liu.
Okay.
Hmm? Yeah, could I thank you? Yeah, I thought, I wasn't sure. I mean, I put my hand up, but it wasn't, people were just jumping in. I agree with what the other woman just said. She said, like, the lower classes, they spend, quote unquote, lower classes spend more of the money on consumables. But from the MMT perspective, I mean, the whole argument that you have to tax someone to pay for something, they don't think you have to tax, you don't have to pay for things sort of in a sense to begin with.
That's right.
Yeah, that's true.
Right. The at least the way I put it is, you do not have to amass funds from taxation or borrowing before you can spend if you are the currency issuing level of the government. That's a lot of words, but that's you know, that's the more precise version of that. And so the problematic part of the slogan, tax the rich to pay for the Green New Deal, is the notion that you have to pay for the Green New Deal with funds amassed from prior taxation. Mm-hmm. And right. That Stephanie Kelton would disagree with, and MMT more generally, because at the level of the currency issuing government, spending precedes taxation, not the other way around. And this actually came up like 2 years ago, 3 years ago, when the Green New Deal was a much more hot item on the political agenda. And even someone like, say, Bernie Sanders, for whom Stephanie Kelton had worked in Congress and whose presidential campaign she had suddenly advised, he would come out with statements like, you know, we got to tax the rich to fund the Green New Deal or to, you know, whatever. And that's, from the MMP perspective, that is simply imprecise. As Stephanie Kelton has put it, and I've heard her say this in person, don't tax the rich to pay for the Green New Deal, tax the rich because they're too damn rich.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I think she made a further point as well. In relation to the Green New Deal, it would be inflationary if there weren't taxes. And she made a further argument that when you tax regular people, that decreases their spending, which decreases demand. Whereas yes. She makes the example that if you tax Bezos, his spending doesn't decrease at all. So taxing them doesn't actually change the inflationary effect. Yeah. That doesn't decrease demand the way it would otherwise.
Yes.
Yeah, I think Patricia was headed in that same direction earlier. Okay. Let's try to move rapidly through the remaining questions so that we have some time available for more general discussion. In chapter 2, Kelton introduces the concept of the federal job guarantee. What is the connection between a federal job guarantee and the United States' monetary sovereignty? Let's see. Navar, would you like to take a stab at that question?
Sure. The federal government can do this job guarantee because no matter how many people show up to accept the offer of the job guarantee and want to participate, the government is able to pay them all and they don't run out of money and say like, oh, sorry, we only budgeted for this many people. We're screwed. Whereas if the city of Boston did that, that's what would happen. Maybe because they would say, oh, we expect like 10,000 to show up. That's how many show up, then 100,000 show up. And that's a bad situation. So you really want to be modern monetary sovereign before you make this commitment.
Okay. Why would the job guarantee have to be financed by the federal government? Mike Sovereign, can you take a stab at that question?
No, I think I'll pass on that.
Okay. Aslam, okay? Okay. Alan.
I don't remember that in the book, but I don't see why it couldn't be done by a private entity like a nonprofit.
Okay. Let me go back to Navar, because I think you actually had the answer to this question. Why would the job guarantee have to be financed by the federal government?
Because if a state government, local government make that commitment, they could run out of money if too many people try to participate.
Okay. So it's connected to the currency issuing power of the federal government. Okay, now here's a much more of an MMT question. how would the, according to MMT, how would the job guarantee stabilize inflation or stabilize the price level? John Bon Jovani, would you like to try that question?
Only if you can repeat it, James.
Okay. How would the job guarantee stabilize inflation?
Well, I'm not going to be able to. I don't think give Stephanie Kelton answer to that. But
I'm looking for a Joe Bon Jovani answer to that.
Oh question. Yeah, well then you know the answer then is that there's this, you know, there's a standardized level of income, you know, that's basically supporting employment in the economy, so that it's an anti-inflationary structural component. But beyond that, you know, when you take the push control, you know, the push and the pull components of inflation, it avoids all of that. It basically takes away, you know, the ability of that to have any influence over the cost of goods, because okay. Incomes are equalized broadly.
Okay. Norman Scott, would you like to add anything to Joe's answer to that question?
Well, I'm a little bit hazy about a couple of the things, but the idea of the idea of full employment is there a natural adjustment of unemployment that certain checks should come in to control that the employment situation.
Okay, would anyone else like to take a stab at this?
I would.
How would the Ruth Cano?
First of all, the unemployed, they don't contribute anything to the economy and can even be detrimental. But if they have a base wage, they have money and they can spend that money back into the economy, and that will make businesses operate more. So that would be a good thing.
Okay, it would be a good thing, but the question more precisely was how would it stabilize prices or stabilize inflation? Now this, I will admit, this question is trickier because it depends upon features of the job guarantee proposal.
I can try
that modern money theory would put forward that are, you know, they're a bit more technical, a bit more subtle, you might say a bit more wonky. And that is that the notion of the job guarantee as it appears in modern money theory is that the job guarantee is at a fixed wage, roughly equivalent to what we have as the minimum wage, but also including benefits, most importantly, health, you know, medical benefits that would be covered by a Medicare for All program. Mm. And the key point of this, and this was originally pointed out by Warren Mosler, founder of MMT, you know, more than 25 years ago, is that the federal government would be able to offer jobs to any person who's involuntarily unemployed, anybody who wants to take the job, at a fixed wage. The federal government can do that because it is the currency issuer. But the wage would be fixed, and it would and by that being what the government is willing to pay for wage, that would anchor the price level. And basically, as the economy improves past a recession, private sector employers,
yep,
could meet their employment needs by hiring people out of the job guarantee labor pool where they have been working, they've maintained their employment history, by offering wages higher than the job guarantee wage. So the idea is that the job guarantee would function as an anchor to the price level, and that's how it would be inflationary. Now, having said that, we acknowledge, of course, that the job guarantee has not been implemented, so we cannot guarantee that this would work perfectly right out of the box. It probably wouldn't. It would need fine tuning, but it is the fixed job guarantee wage is an important aspect of the MMT concept of the job guarantee. And I say that because there are other concepts of jobs for all that do not, that basically say, well, we'll have different tiers of wages, job guarantee wages, for labor of different skills, different skill classes of labor. And the MMT people have been very critical of this notion that there might be different tiers of labor, different tiers of wages in a job guarantee program. Okay. Let's see.
Can I ask you something?
Yes.
First of all, I don't have any hand raised thing. I see my MacBook on the bottom, so I butt in.
Yeah, I have not been looking at the participants window so far, so just go ahead. We will in a minute.
Yeah. Yeah, so anyway, she was saying that the proponents of MMT, modern MMT proponents, talk about the caring economy. And there was a news story today or yesterday about how there's really a lack of workers to like watch people, like wraparounds, like to watch, say, somebody's mentally challenged son, like, with Down syndrome, they're used to having somebody take care of them, and they can't find anybody because nobody's going to be working for like $11 an hour or less than that. Like that's what they were talking about. So I was thinking with this federal, I think that's what they were thinking of, the federal minimum being around $15 an hour would pull people in where they're needed, child care and all that stuff. But that's okay. Yeah. And then the businesses, like you said, they're free to draw people off, like with maybe higher skill levels they peel them off when the economy improves.
Okay. Okay.
Jim, this is Ed Dodson. I have a question for you. Is Stephanie going to later argue that this would take the replace of unemployment insurance, welfare benefits, and other kinds of social welfare payments?
I don't know if Stephanie addresses this per se in this book, but I know that I've read sections of work by Randy Ray in which he discusses this. The idea of the federal job guarantee paid at the job guarantee at a job guarantee wage would not in terms of law or in terms of public administration replace unemployment benefits or replace current minimum wage laws, but it would effectively supersede them. Because for one thing, the job guarantee wage is intended to be higher than what you can get in unemployment compensation in any state of the United States.
Yeah, yeah.
It will be higher than the minimum wage, but will come with in the proposal it comes with the Medicare for all and sort of basic benefits like that the federal minimum wage doesn't come with, and that state minimum wage doesn't come with. So it's not as if unemployment compensation laws or minimum wage laws would need to be repealed in order to have the job guarantee. But they would be, the intention is that they be effectively superseded. Does that help?
I think it's, it just brings up a whole set of complex governmental relationship kind of overlapping issues. And, you know, for example, when you say it would supersede, well, maybe the combined benefits in a state like Massachusetts would make the job guarantee program at the federal level, something people would try to not take advantage of. Well, but the question is, would you be required, you know, in other words, would you be absolutely required to accept a job in order to get any benefit package? And then, I don't think you don't need to respond to that. Just in my mind, I'm looking for more details of how such a program would be implemented and how it would affect other existing programs in terms of eligibility and administration.
Okay, so.
I've got a question.
Let me just give a reading suggestion for Ed and for anyone else. And that is another book that came out from the MMT world in 2020. It's called The Case for the Job Guarantee. It's by Pavlina Cherneva. The last name is spelled T-C-H-E-R-N-A-V-A, The Case for the Job Guarantee. If someone wants to put it into the Slack channel, you'll find it very easily. And this is a very sort of slim book that is aimed at general audiences. It's even less technical than Stephanie Kelton's book. And there you will find much discussion of how how a job guarantee program would work, how, for example, it would be funded at the federal level, implemented at the state and local government level. It's not going to answer all of your questions because, of course, the job guarantee has not really been tried in the United States, at least. And so we don't have the benefit of concrete experience to develop a fine-tuned proposal. But there's a whole range of discussion there. You can, of course, also conduct an internet search for the job guarantee. You'll come across the name Pavlina Cherneva. You'll come across her website. She has a website, Job Guarantee Frequently Asked Questions.
Got it, thanks.
And then, you know, you can hit me up with questions once you've read some of Pavlina Cherneva's book. Randy Ray also has a lot about the job guarantee. Okay, I'd like to, in fact, having said that, we actually touched upon the next question, what would be the difference between the job guarantee wage and current federal, state, and local minimum wage laws? We don't need to discuss that more here, but let's discuss the final two bullet points, which I actually should be one question. Stephanie Kelton writes, quote, "The threat to our common well-being isn't the budget deficit, it's excessive inflation." She later writes, yeah. "Under current budgeting procedures, Congress doesn't have to consider inflation risk when it wants to spend more." And my question in response to that is, how would consideration of inflation risk be integrated into the federal budgetary decision-making process? Let's see if there's anybody who has not yet had a chance to speak. Norman Scott, would you like to take a stab at that question? How would consideration of inflation risk be integrated into the federal budgetary decision-making process?
Well, hold on a second. I didn't get the full flavor, but I did see that the inflation is related to the level of overheated economy, and that it's almost like the inflation will be integrated until it reaches a point where it won't be, in a sense. I was thinking of the sponge, that you have a sponge with money, and as long as the sponge can absorb the water, but when it starts to overflow, it sort of begins to become a problem.
Okay. Melvin Diaz, would you like to take a stab at that question? How would consideration of inflation risk be integrated into the federal budgetary decision-making process?
Inflation is actually the price level of goods and services. The change in price and goods and level services is defined as rate of inflation. And continued inflation will make changes in interest rates by the federal government.
Okay. The question is looking a bit more specifically at the federal budgetary decision-making process. At this point, I'm going to start looking at the participants window for raised hands. Navarre, you have your hand raised.
I'm sorry, I was distracted for a second there. We still had this question of about the about how we're going to score the projects for if they're going to cause inflation.
How would consideration of inflation risk be integrated into the federal budgetary decision-making process?
Oh, okay. Well, she sort of alludes to the idea that right now when it goes to the Congressional Budget Office, which I guess for the House, they tell what the long-term deficit impact is going to be, but that's really budgetary, and that's not what she thinks they should focus on. She sort of says they should flag any issues of real resources that this is going to use. I think she sort of alludes to that idea that they would do something smarter, basically, at the Congressional Budget Office, and really flag these issues of how it's going to create. I guess it would usually be demand pull inflation if they want too much. If they're doing too much, basically, and they could flag that and sort of recommend a way to make sure that they're raising taxes in a way that'll be productive to reduce that inflation risk.
Okay. At this point, everybody in the Zoom window has spoken at least once or had the opportunity to speak. So, and we actually completed the study question. So now I think I'm just going to go through the participants window and recognize people whose hands are raised. We have about 12 minutes left in the session. So if you would like to make some remarks, please try to keep them brief. Let's call upon Alan.
Yeah, the main thing for getting rid of inflation is to get rid of monopolies. That's what's causing most of the inflation right now, especially with the gasoline companies, the oil companies. The other thing I wanted to mention too is that, is it possible to use MMT to provide universal basic income for everybody in the United States? Something like they do in Alaska.
I'm not going to respond to that question now because it's going to take more time.
Okay.
But we'll see if we can work that in the remaining three sessions of the course.
Great.
Marty Rowland.
Yeah, so the question I had that, or the answer I had for the last question had to do with, when you budget, you're making decision doing this or that. So if you had a budget that was going to allow currency to circulate better, then it'd be wiser to do something like that for a lot of low-income people than to do something like a tax cut or financing a war. But the question I had to do, I put into Slack a observation from the New York Times about how Zelensky thinks that he's going to beat the Russians by impacting their economy through sanctions. And I commented, well, if Russia would make its currency sovereign, they'd never run out of money. So is Russia's currency sovereign, or could it be?
Interesting.
Well, I think it would.
Right.
They issue their own currency, the ruble. It's not convertible into gold, as far as I know. It's not pegged to any other currency. So that means that it's at least partially monetarily sovereign.
Okay, so they'll never run out of missiles and bombs.
Well, no, but one of the points of MMT is that, well, first let me say, I don't know what Russia's position is with regard to borrowing in foreign currencies, whether they have borrowed in dollars or euros or whatever, that is the Russian government. I simply do not know. If they have, then that's a limitation on their monetary sovereignty. But the point about MMT is that a monetarily sovereign currency issuing government can always finance the purchase of any goods and services that are available for purchase in that currency. Hmm. Well, the focus of MMT is always to say, well, what are the real productive resources available
mm-hmm.
to
yeah.
the government of a country? That's the real question to ask.
Person. Uh-huh.
So got other people with raised hands. Neil H.
Yeah. Mine were in relation to the job guarantee program, and specifically it's as an automatic stabilizer. I didn't really find it particularly convincing. I was wondering, one is this a core of MMT proposals, or is this specific to Stephanie? And then I had another point after that.
It's found among almost all MMT advocates.
Okay.
If we recall the three phrases, what does happen, what can happen, and what should happen. I place the job guarantee primarily as what can happen, in that it is an inherent possibility or potentiality of a monetarily sovereign government that they can offer a job at a fixed wage to anyone who is involuntarily unemployed. To say that it can happen is not necessarily to say that it should happen, though almost all the job guarantee advocates in this country, at least, are very strong on the job guarantee. In the United Kingdom, Richard Murphy, who I really like, he is less concerned with the job guarantee. So I would say that the possibility is inherent in MMT. How it would be implemented, what other policies need to be implemented as well, those are up for debate.
Yeah, and then the point I had is I didn't really see how it was, she kind of brushed over it or didn't really argue very strongly that it would actually stabilize inflation, because her argument seemed to be that employers would be able to respond to inflation by increasing supply, by drawing on this pool of employees. And one criticism is that they're going to have to pay more for those employees. She herself says private sector wages would be a premium. So although it would increase supply, it would also presumably increase demand by having more money. That was one point I had.
I think one of the points that she would make is that private sector wages are always at a premium because the effective wage of the unemployed is zero.
Mm.
So the Australian MMT economist Bill Mitchell uses the metaphor of a buffer stock. He points out that right now, and this is particularly true in the Phillips curve line of thinking in economics, you control inflation by increasing or decreasing the size of the buffer stock of unemployed people. Which causes a lot of suffering, and the MMT job guarantee conception emphasizes that what we will now have is a buffer stock of employed people. They're employed by the job guarantee program. Their employment histories are maintained. But at the same time, the job guarantee wage is the effective minimum wage, so that having all those people in the job guarantee pool, since they're being paid what is an effective minimum wage, means that they're not putting upward pressure on prices. There's no real possibility of a wage push inflation in the job guarantee pool, because the pool...
Well, as they move from that pool to the private sector pool, the wages would go up.
Well, that's presumably responding to the, the profit-making opportunities in the private sector. The private sector would not offer jobs if it increase their costs and led to the possibility of them not making profits.
Okay, so, that makes sense. Okay.
So you see, it's designed to work somewhat with the normal impulses of the private sector.
Okay, and the other criticism I just had was that she thought that I was kind of relying on a human capital theory that economists purport, which I think only economists really believe in it, but that people would be more likely to hire these people who are on the government job guarantee because they're not out of work, which I think it'd be far more likely that being on this government job guarantee would be a black mark and not something you would want other employers to know about if I was to be in a real world about it.
I'm not going to say that won't happen because this program hasn't been implemented, so we don't know how it would work. What we do know is that if you are unemployed, at least in the U.S. for more than 3 months or especially more than 6 months, your employment prospects really dim because private sector employers, they really want to see that continuity of employment history. So the MMT job guarantee program is really designed to help people maintain continuity of employment history so that they're acceptable for possible transfer to private sector employment.
Yeah, I think the reasoning of that is reliant on human capital. For example, if someone wasn't unemployed for a year because they were traveling the world, I think employers would actually find that very endearing, and it would be very positive in an interview or otherwise, because it's indicative that at the very least you're moneyed, but also that you're.
Anyway, we have only 2 minutes left. Joe Bongiovanni. Unmute, please.
Unmute.
Okay. I was just going to observe that Russia has $40 billion in outside currency obligations, that is to say, mostly in dollars and euros. And, you know, the situation that this gets into the question of monetary sovereignty versus sanctions, you know, because the sanctions are preventing Russia from getting into the capital market, a foreign exchange market, excuse me, where it could acquire dollars to pay those bills. But they're prevented from doing so. And now they're threatening that they're going to just pay it in rubles. And the ratings agencies are going to say that they're in default. So we have all of these things that are going on in the world of, you know, Uber finance and Uber theft is what I consider it, as far as the sanctions goes. And that really complicates all these monetary issues. Over.
Okay. We have 1 minute left, and I'm going to reserve them to myself, mainly for the purpose of reminding you that with next week's session, we begin covering two chapters at a time. So next week's session, week four, we're actually going to be discussing chapters 3 and 4 in Stephanie Kelton's The Deficit Myth. And I'll let you know in advance that the material does get, you know, more advanced, more technical. And you will have to dig in and try to be asking yourself if you understand what Kelton is arguing here. And the discussion questions are intended to guide you to a better understanding of what she's arguing. And please feel free to post questions in the Slack channel. I go in there several times a week so that if there are points about the reading that you do not understand, you can post them there, and I'll try my best to respond to them so that you have a better understanding and a better ability to answer the discussion questions. Ibrahima?
Thank you, Jim. Thank you, everyone, for coming. And we will meet again next week. And by the way, we are having a new class starting next week, public banking with Alec.
Wow.
So that's the class that we are organizing together with the Rocky Mountains Public Banking Institute. So we hope to see you all. Thank you.
Thank you.